One will arrive there in the capital along wide avenues containing the triumphal arch, the pantheon of the army, the square of the people, things to take your breath away. Let it be built on such a scale that St. Peter's and its square will seem like toys in comparison. Those who enter the Reich Chancellery should feel that they stand before the lords of the world.
This was Adolf Hitler's grandiose vision for Germania, a kind of hyper-Rome to be built on top of Berlin as the new capital of his thousand-year Reich. In the end, Tempelhof Airport was one of the few of these edifices actually to be built here. It gives us a glimpse of an empire that might have been. From here, Hitler intended, the Aryan race would rule over vast tracts of Lebensraum, living space. Scheduled flights would allow the elite of the master race to fly from the capital to the Ukraine in a matter of hours. Thousands of miles to the east, Hitler's allies, the Japanese, were busy building their own version of Lebensraum, carving out a vast new empire in China and Southeast Asia. Together, Germany and Japan were creating a new world order in which the Aryan and Yamato peoples would be the masters. Their megalomaniac visions came much closer to being realized than most people like to admit. Between 1937 and 1942, no army seemed able to withstand them. The 20th century was a 100-year conflict, a war of the world. By its midpoint, it was these bold new empire states, with their racial theories and totalitarian methods, that seemed poised to win it.
1942 was the year the world teetered on a knife edge. It was the year the whole map of Eurasia appeared to have been redrawn. From the Rhine to the Volga, from Manchuria to the Marshall Islands, huge tracts of land had changed political hands. Now, in the name of living space, they were to change populations too. But the methods the Axis powers used to build their empires meant that living space soon turned into killing space. This is the Yasukuni Shrine in Tokyo, which houses the souls of the 2.5 million service personnel who've died in battle since the 1860s. Every year, 6 million Japanese come here to worship those who laid down their lives for emperor and country.
Among the officially enshrined martyrs are 14 Class A war criminals. One of them is General Iwane Matsui, commander-in-chief of the Japanese forces in central China in 1937. Matsui was subsequently tried for his involvement in one of the most horrific atrocities of the Second World War. The Rape of Nanjing. From the moment full-scale war broke out between Japan and China, General Matsui's Imperial Army inflicted defeat after defeat on the forces of the Chinese leader Chiang Kai-shek. But the fighting was harder than they'd expected. In the hope of ending the war, the Japanese determined to make an example of Chiang's capital, Nanjing. As they fought their way along the road from Shanghai, the Japanese soldiers provided a foretaste of what was to come. They indulged in killing competitions, which were covered by the media like sporting events. On the 7th of December 1937, this headline appeared in the Tokyo Nichi Nichi newspaper.
Sub-Lieutenant Mukai Toshiaki and Sub-Lieutenant Noda Takeshi, both of the Katagiri unit at Kuyang, in a friendly contest to see which of them will first fell 100 Chinese in individual sword combat, are well in the final phase of their race, running almost neck to neck. On Sunday, the score was Mukai 89 and Noda 78.
As news of the approaching Japanese army reached the city of Nanjing, the Chinese authorities decided to shut all but one of the gates in the wall that encircled the city. In a vain attempt to keep the marauding invaders out, they ended up locking the defenseless inhabitants in.
The Japanese 10th Army, under the command of the Emperor Hirohito's uncle, Prince Asaka Yoshihiko, arrived here at Nanjing city walls on December the 8th, 1937. The 30,000 battle-weary but still bloodthirsty troops quickly surrounded the city, though before they sealed it off, the Chinese leader Chiang Kai-shek was able to make his escape. 5 days later, the Japanese broke through the city gates. What they found inside was a ready-made abattoir.
Prisoners were murdered in their tens of thousands, bayoneted, beheaded, and buried alive. And not only military prisoners, the violence swiftly became indiscriminate. Asked by a journalist to justify what had happened, Lieutenant Colonel Ryukichi Tanaka gave a chilling reply.
Frankly speaking, you and I have diametrically different views of the Chinese. You may be dealing with them as human beings, but I regard them as swine. We can do anything to such creatures.
As Stalin's henchmen were treating distrusted ethnic minorities in the Soviet Union, as the Nazis would soon treat the Jews of Europe, so the Japanese thought of and treated the Chinese as subhumans. There had been massacres in history before, of course. But there was something different about 20th century violence, apart from its sheer scale. Its spuriously biological rationale.
This capacity for regarding human beings as members of a distinct and potentially malignant species, not just as animals, but as vermin, was one of the reasons why 20th century extraordinarily violent. Only make that mental leap, and warfare ceases to be an encounter between two uniformed armies. It becomes a matter of annihilation, in which everyone on the side, men, children and the elderly, can legitimately be slaughtered.
Exemplary violence isn't just about killing. It's about humiliating as well. Events in Nanjing revealed another distinctive characteristic of 20th century conflict. That when violence was extended to civilians, it readily mutated into sexual violence. Perhaps the most striking feature of the attack on Nanjing were the rapes. Anything between 8,000 and 20,000 Chinese women were subjected to the most hideous sexual assaults. As one Japanese soldier, Takahiro Kozo, later confessed.
Women suffered most. No matter how young or old, not one could escape the fate of being raped. We sent out trucks to the city streets and villages to seize a lot of women. And then each of them was allocated 15 to 20 soldiers for sexual intercourse and abuse.
What are we to make of this behavior? Were Japanese troops somehow giving in to a primeval urge to impregnate the women of their enemy? Is it possible for men simultaneously to despise people as vermin and yet to desire them? Or was rape just bayoneting by other means?
The International Military Tribunal of the Far East found that General Matsui had failed to control his own troops in Nanjing. In 1948, he was sentenced to hang. The tribunal estimated that more than 260,000 civilians had died at the hands of Japanese soldiers.